Good morning and welcome once again to worship from the Newnan First United Methodist Church in Newnan, Georgia. My name is Charles Robinson. I'm privileged to serve as the senior pastor here and to welcome you to this service. We thank you for your response to our previous services as we continue to move through this time of transition and uncertainty. I'm grateful to all of those on our staff and others who make this possible. And we are delighted that you've chosen to be a part of this service today. We continue to move forward, putting plans in place for that marvelous day, wonderful day, when we'll be able to gather in this house of worship once again. But until that day, we'll continue to come to you in this fashion. We welcome your response and your anything, any suggestions you have that will help us to be more effective in staying connected with you and with this community and with this world that God loves so much. We continue in this holy season of Easter as we move toward the day of Ascension and the day of Pentecost. Once again, welcome. Stay informed through our website, and we will let you know when we can all gather once again. Thank you for being with us.
It's so good to be with you again on this glorious Sunday morning. I am in a little bit different location today, but for some of you, this is a very familiar place. I'm back in our children's worship room. It is so good to be back in a familiar space with you. And I can't wait until we're all here physically together in this room worshiping God. But for now, we're going to talk about a story where all of Jesus' disciples gathered together in a room very similar to the one I'm sitting in. This is after Jesus has resurrected from the tomb, but his disciples haven't seen him yet. So, in our children's Bible, I'm going to begin reading. Jesus appears to a room full of friends. One night, Jesus appeared in a room where many of his friends were gathered. He told them to tell their family and friends and neighbors and even strangers that he is alive. He told them to share everything he had taught them. They were to tell the people in Jerusalem first, but then they were to tell people everywhere. Jesus told them to wait in Jerusalem until God sent them a special gift of power from heaven. Now, most of Jesus' friends were there in that room, but there was one friend named Thomas who was not there. Well, when Jesus' friends saw Thomas again, they said, "Thomas, you're not going to believe it. We just saw Jesus. He's alive." And do you know what Thomas said? He said, "I don't believe it. Not until I see him with my own eyes will I believe that Jesus is alive." I don't know about you, but I can relate to not believing something until I've seen it. For example, would you believe that an ostrich's eyeball is actually bigger than its brain? Or that the ridges around a dime, there's 118. You can go count them if you need something to do today. All that to say, sometimes it's hard to believe things until we see them. Well, Thomas was not to be left out for long. Jesus appeared to his disciples soon again, and Thomas was there. Thomas saw Jesus, fell down, and worshiped him, saying, "My Lord, my God." Jesus tells each of us, "Blessed are those that believe without seeing." Friends, we may not be here together, but we are still the church. Okay? We may not be seeing each other across the aisle or in the same room, but we believe that we are still together in the Spirit of Christ. Would you please repeat after me with this prayer? Dear God, thank you for always being with us. Thank you for keeping us close and helping us believe in you even while we are apart. We love you. Amen. Until next week, friends, God bless.
Our voices and this historic confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now let us unite our hearts in prayer. Gracious and eternal, loving Almighty God, we come before you on this holy day. Hearts filled with gratitude and adoration and praise for who you are and for your amazing love for each of us. We ask that you would receive our praise, receive our adoration, Lord God. Our words fail us, but we are grateful for who you are and for how you love us. We come before you also, Lord God, in a spirit of confession, looking deep into our own hearts and realizing there are places that need your healing touch, words unspoken that we should have spoken, words said that were hurtful. Forgive us and restore us that we might worthily serve you. And hear us, Lord God, as we come before you in a spirit of intercession. There's so much hurt, so much pain, so much anxiety and worry and fear in our world and in our hearts right now. And we pray that we would be reminded that you are our refuge and our strength and our very present help, that you sent your Son, our Savior, to teach us how to love and how to walk through days of difficulty and darkness and fear, knowing that we walk in the light of the Holy Spirit that he sends each and every day. Lord God, be with those who are in pain, those who suffer this day. Help us to know how we can be more kind and more gracious. Teach us a new spirit of generosity and a new way of walking with you. Guide our world, guide our leaders, strengthen us to serve you in all that we say and do. And be with us as we look into our own hearts and examine our own fears. And where we find faith wrestling with fear, we pray for victory for faith. Remind us, Lord God, of how you've claimed the victory and resurrection, victory over the forces of darkness and sin and evil. And we pray for the day, Lord God, when we can once again gather in your house. But until that day comes, help us to be faithful in all of our actions and all of our words. For we pray to you in the name of your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray to you, to pray together with the confidence of children. And as we pray, to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stay tuned to the Newnan First United Methodist Church Missions Facebook page. There you will find opportunities to serve that emerge daily. Remember that River Life, livetheriverlife.com, has opportunities for families to serve in small groups. And also, this week, we were able to be part of the kickoff of the new feeding program for the Grantville and Moreland areas at Glanton Elementary School. We are so thrilled to be able to be partners in mission with so many community agencies, and I know that your heart is reaching out to others with the love of God through your prayers, through your volunteer efforts. I want you to still send in those pictures and videos so that we can continue to work towards a celebration of all that's being done. Make sure to include yourself in the pictures and to let us see all that God is doing through you, through his disciples. Would you pray with me as we take this opportunity and this time in worship to give? Father, we come before you asking that our tithes, our offerings, our extra mile giving would go to serving you. We want to reach out to others in your name. We want to make sure your name is known. And we want to, especially during this time of a pandemic, that we are doing all we can to love our neighbor well. We seek you and we seek to serve you as we welcome, love, and serve all in your name. Amen. Be blessed, be well, be a blessing. Amen.
And who told the world? Today's scripture lesson is found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem, and do you not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in his word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But he had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?' They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, 'It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon.' Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Most of us are familiar with this passage today. This is the well-known Emmaus story. This text is the basis for the Walk to Emmaus spiritual pilgrimages that many in our congregation have participated in. And it gives us a glimpse at some of the previously unnamed disciples and followers of Jesus. The scene opens with these two who are identified as disciples walking along the road together toward their home. We can imagine the scene based on the little clues we get a little later. It's sometime on Sunday, a few days after the crucifixion. They are still in shock and sadness at all that has happened. If you've ever been extremely sad yourself, you can guess that they aren't walking along the road very quickly as they discuss all that has happened in the last few days. Then we are told that Jesus appears walking along beside them, but they are prevented from recognizing him. They welcome this apparent stranger to walk with them and begin telling him all the things that have happened in the last few days that have them feeling sad and distraught. They had thought Jesus would be the one to redeem Israel, and yet now he is dead. Now, we've all been there. Things are going along smoothly. We thought we knew how everything was going to turn out. The perfect school, the perfect job, the perfect relationship. Then it doesn't go at all how you pictured it going in your head. It all falls apart, and you feel as if the world is going to end. This is basically what they tell the stranger about all that Jesus had meant to them. They may have had to explain about Jesus, since this stranger didn't seem to know who Jesus was, and the recent events that had happened there in Jerusalem in order for this stranger to understand why they were so distressed as they were walking along. But they only have to give the briefest outline of how Jesus died in order for the stranger to understand that part. Saying he'd been handed over to be sentenced to death and then crucified would have been enough. Only the Roman authorities could sentence someone to death, and crucifixion was a particularly gruesome execution reserved for certain classes of people and certain crimes. Even if the stranger did not know Jesus, he would know that much. That would tell him a lot about this person that they were so sad about. After providing the overview of all that Jesus had taught them, and then this brief recounting of his torturous death only a few days before, the story turns. I can almost imagine Cleopas kind of chuckling darkly as he tells this stranger about the claims of the women from that morning. Maybe he chalks it up to hallucinations and their grief. Maybe he thinks they're just making things up. Truth is, he doesn't really quite know what to make of these stories. But as he makes his way home after the turmoil and emotional pain suffered in the last few days, he can't help but share this last tidbit with this stranger as well. The women claimed they showed up at the tomb that morning and it was empty. Not only that, they saw a vision of angels telling them that Jesus is alive. Can you believe it? I can just see Cleopas shaking his head in disbelief as he tells this tale. Sure, some of the other disciples had gone out to the tomb and verified it was empty, but none of them reported visions like the women had. Now, of course, the companion with Cleopas, the other disciple walking along with him, is given no words here. In fact, the other disciple is not even given a name. Some have suggested that this is because the other disciple is Cleopas' wife. As the other disciple is not giving the honor of a name, and as they share a home together, it does make a certain amount of sense. If this is his wife, I can imagine her rolling her eyes at him as he shares this story. So now I'm trying to imagine a time in our modern world when we would continue to share a journey with someone after what happens next in the story. This stranger calls them fools for failing to understand what they had experienced. Seriously, I want you to try and imagine this. Imagine you're walking through the park one day and you're feeling sad. Perhaps someone close to you has died, or you've just received the worst news you've ever received. And someone, a stranger, notices that something is wrong, that something's bothering you, and they come over and strike up a conversation to ask what's going on with you. And so you walk along for a time, telling a story of all that you've been through, and then their first response is to call you a fool. I suspect most of us wouldn't have stuck around to hear why they thought we were a fool. At best, I imagine we would call them something perhaps unkind, something you can't repeat at church, and would have stormed away. At worst, I imagine this could have led to some sort of physical violence of one sort or another. But not here. Maybe some sort of divine influence, the same divine influence that keeps them from recognizing Jesus, keeps them from sending this stranger away after calling them fools. But in that moment, whatever the reason, we get our first glimpse at another way of being. They decide to hear the stranger out rather than making assumptions and immediately sending him away. It is perhaps a small thing, but it's a hint of something bigger still to come. And so as they continue walking, this stranger, Jesus in disguise, explains all of their scriptures from Moses through the prophets. Perhaps now they are ready to hear what Jesus had tried to teach them about all along. Perhaps now they are finally able to comprehend how all that has happened, all that Jesus had taught them before, even the confusing story told by the women that morning, all of it is in fulfillment of the scriptures. Now, eventually, they do make it to Emmaus. Try to imagine how long that walk took. 7 miles over dirt roads when you are feeling so distraught and overwhelmed by grief. Even with this stranger for company and his way of discussing things, I'm sure the journey took much of the day, and so it is nearly evening by the time they get home. As they near their home, this couple invite the stranger to join them for the evening. Perhaps the conversation was just so engaging that they did not yet want it to end. Perhaps they feared that for this stranger being out after dark with no other place to go and no protection from the night. Perhaps they were simply trying to be kind. Whatever the reason, they invited this stranger who opened his conversation with them by calling them fools to come into their home for the night. They offered him a place to sleep. They invited him to share a meal with them. As they sat at the table, he took bread, blessed and broke it and gave it to him. And in that moment, they recognized him. Now, normally, this is the key point, the key takeaway from this passage. As those disciples gathered to share a meal, Jesus was recognized in their midst in the breaking of the bread. This is an element of our own worship life together. One of the times we are most aware of Jesus in our midst is when we come to this table and we break bread and share it together. And while we cannot physically gather together right now as a single body, we can, as these two disciples did, remember and recognize Jesus in our midst every time we come to the table in our own homes. In the past, in reflecting on this passage, I would have finished my message reflecting a bit further on the part of the story, on this part of the story, and all that was possible in the lives of these disciples after they had recognized Christ in their midst. But something different struck me this time. Yes, it was at the moment that the bread was broken that the disciples finally realized who it was at the table with them. But we cannot forget all that happened along the way up to that moment, leading them there to that realization. For in truth, Jesus was there with them the whole time, even though they failed to recognize him. He was there with them as they walked that sad journey home. He was there with them as evening approached. He was there with them as they entered their house. He was there with them as they prepared a meal and brought it to the table for all of them to eat. This stranger had approached them on their journey home. They were under no real obligation to journey with this person that they did not know, especially after he calls them fools. And yet, they continued to journey with him and continued to have this conversation. As they approached their home, they chose to perform an act of service for this stranger. They invited him into their home. They invited him to their table, and they served him a meal. And it is in the midst of this act of service that they recognized him. Yes, they recognized him as he broke the bread with a blessing, but it was their service that made it possible for them to recognize that Jesus was there with them at all. Without their act of service, chances are they never would have realized that Jesus was the stranger that had traveled with them that day. Without their kindness to one who we would perceive as acting rudely to them in the first place, this story would likely not be here for us to read today. And yet, here we are today, still telling this story, still reflecting on these two disciples. As we move through these times of uncertainty, we can have some sense of the sadness and the distress that these two were feeling on their way home that day. Many of us long to gather together again so that we can be reminded of the body of Christ gathered together, so that we can recognize Christ in our midst as we break bread together. But we all must also remember that it is through our kindness and our service to others that we welcome Christ into our midst. It is our welcome and our actions that open us to the possibility of meeting Christ and all of those that we meet every day. While we continue in these trying times in which nothing seems to make sense, we remember our place in the story. We are reminded that Jesus is here with us even when we cannot recognize him. We remember that we are called to love and to serve others. We remember that through this love and service, others will come to recognize Christ in our midst. We remember that through our compassion to one another, we open ourselves to recognize that Christ is here with us. May we continue to be the body of Christ to a world in need of God's love. Amen. For our closing hymn today, we will sing one of my favorite hymns, the Servant Song. This hymn touches exactly on this idea of recognizing Christ in the ways in which we serve one another. The words will appear on your screen, and I invite you to join us in song. As we think about where Jesus is in the time ahead, we are reminded that he is with us even when we are not aware of it. And we are also brought to mind that one of the ways that we recognize Jesus is when we are serving others. And so as we go forth today, let us go forth to love God and to serve our neighbors. Let us go forth to serve God and to love our neighbors. Go in peace.